Start? Okay. Well, welcome everybody. My name is Margaret O'Neill. I'm with Juneau Economic Development Council, and I've been asked to speak about how people can finance businesses in Juneau. And there's a handout up on that podium there that I put just some links that I'm going to refer to so you can have sort of a takeaway. My business card is there if you have any questions. I'm going to try and go through things pretty quickly. There's a interactive portion of this we have a website that I'm just kind of click to from this presentation, but if you have questions, just stop me anytime. So are any of you in business or thinking about being in business? Okay, but nothing now. So these would be new ventures starting up from scratch? Okay, that's good to know. Do you feel comfortable talking about your business? I don't want to ask pointed questions if it's big secret. Sometimes people are, they don't want to give away their ideas. And so anyway, hopefully this will be fairly loose. Anyway, I work for Juneau Economic Development Council. And if you don't know about us, we're the local economic development agency for the city and borough of Juneau. We were chartered, it says 25 years, but it's actually our 26th year this year. And we're a nonprofit in Juneau working actually collaboratively with lots of different organizations throughout the region to help improve the economic competitiveness of the region. We have an 11-member board that is appointed by the City and Borough of Juneau Assembly. The mayor is always on our board. The chancellor of the university is always on our board. And we always have a labor representative on our board. But the rest of the members are from a kind of a broad spectrum of business and government and even nonprofit organizations. We have a kind of a core grant that we get from the City and Borough of Juneau, but most of our money comes from state and federal grants, and we have a certain amount of fee income. This is our mission: strengthen Juneau's economy, develop the region, help Juneau seem like a better place to live, and try and do new and exciting things. So you're interested in financing, and so we want to talk about the reasons to take out a loan. For business, the easiest reason to get a loan is if you're already in business, you have a positive track record, you're making money, and you're outgrown your equipment or your premises, or you want to hire a lot more people, but the revenues that are going to support that haven't yet materialized. That's the best time to get financing, and there are lots of resources for that. That's the easiest time to walk into a bank and get a loan. The hardest time is for startups, and so because you don't have any track record, you can mitigate that to some extent by if you're in a business that maybe you've been working as a chef in a restaurant for many years, and you have a clientele that comes to you, and you want to start your own restaurant. You can translate that experience very easily into a new business, and it's easier to get financing. But for most businesses, particularly if you're doing something that's new or different in the community or is hard to understand, it isn't a restaurant or a gift shop or a CPA firm or something else that's easy to understand, and there's a sort of a lot of comparables, then it's harder for bankers to understand what you're doing and see what the potential is and how they're going to get paid. Another time that's really hard is after a period of losses. So if things aren't going well, it's really important to get advice to fix those problems before. It's really hard to finance your way out of it. Sometimes it's possible if your debt's poorly structured, it's not that you're losing money, it's just that the cash flow isn't working, then you can do it. But it can also, it's just harder. So in order to get financing, you should do your homework and really pay attention to what the banks want. These are what everybody refers to as the 5 C's of credit. And lenders look at them every time. They may call it different things. But capacity is the most important thing. And when I worked for Bank of America, they say, every day, we are cash flow lenders. You know, it's not the past that's going to pay us back. It's what they're going to do in the future. So this is where you have to demonstrate from your financial projections that your business is going to generate sufficient cash, not just profits, but cash, that is going to be available to pay back the loan according to the terms that, you know, that are offered or that you've negotiated. And the other things that can affect capacity is how much you're borrowing is a percentage of your, you know, you have like more net worth. Could you borrow more money later from somebody else if you needed to get more? If something didn't pan out and you needed additional working capital to weather some unforeseen circumstance, that's where they're going to look at the difference between your assets and your liabilities. If you've, a lot of companies, particularly ones where they have like a lot of partners, the partners will put money in, but they'll put it in as debt rather than equity. And so that makes your balance sheet look really weak. It doesn't, you know, if there's all these other people that are expecting to get paid back from this business, where am I going to stand in relation to all of them when I'm looking at getting my piece of your cash flow? So the capital is part of that. It's like, how much capital do you need? How much capital do you have? Have you committed any of your own resources? You know, are you trying to do all of this with only other people's money, or have you invested in it as well? You know, are you willing to put up, put your own money? And some people borrow against their retirement, or they sell something to come up with their own capital. And then the banks always look at collateral too. It's interesting, in the last maybe 10 years or so, the banks have kind of changed. Some are really focused on collateral, and some will say, you know, I don't want the collateral anyway. I'm going to do this only as an unsecured loan. If it doesn't fly, you know, on the basis of the borrower's credit and cash flow, we're not going to do it at all. If you can meet that test, you'll save a lot of money on your financing because you'll be paying a lower interest rate. And you don't have to pay for appraisals and all the other kinds of things that can really add to the cost of financing. But most banks want to see collateral. And depending on what you want to borrow the money for, that's where your collateral has to be different things. So banks will typically lend maybe 50% for inventory. So if you had a retail store and you were buying clothing to resell, they would pay 50% of the cost of the inventory. So if you're buying t-shirts at $10, they'll give you $5 for the shirt. You have to come up with the other $5, and then you sell it for $20, and you pay back the loan with that. Inventory loans are usually 50%. If you have a kind of a business where you're doing work on contract, like maybe a contracting firm, like a government contractor, or say you had a janitorial business and you had contract to clean this office building, they would loan 75% of your receivables. So there's that 60-day lag between when you bill and when you get paid. You need the cash to pay your workers, so forth. Then the bank will look at what your receivables are and they'll loan 75% of that. And then real estate, you can plan on putting 25 to 30% down, depending on what it is. 20 to 25% down for real estate purchases, like if you want to buy a building. And then the conditions are, you know, how long you've been in business, what kind of industry you're in. Banks will look at, they'll get burned on a hotel deal, and then they won't make any more hotel loans. The restaurants are typical thing where some financial institutions will get their knickers in a twist about a certain industry. But then there are also real industry issues like the timber industry in Southeast Alaska, when it sort of collapsed, then nobody would lend any money for sawmills or, you know, logging trucks or any kind of thing, because they felt like the industry was deteriorating and there was no market. And so global factors play into that to some extent. And then the last one is character. And this is how long you've been in business, whether you're really experienced enough to do the things that you say you want to do, what your credit looks like. I mean, if you have good credit or they have a past history with you where you haven't been able to pay your loans on time, those kinds of things are, reasons why a loan will be approved. And all of these things affect pricing. So the stronger you are with respect to these, the lower the cost of your interest and fees that you can expect to pay. So one of the ways of preparing for what lenders look at is to get a credit reports on yourself. I put these resources on the handout there on there. You can get free credit reports. The credit score, a lot of bank systems, especially the big banks, Wells Fargo, KeyBank, they all look at credit score, and you just need to manage that. And it's a good thing to look at it regularly just to make sure that there's no mistakes or somebody's gotten credit in your name. Those kinds of identity theft things seem to really play up. But sometimes it's just mistakes. But you can, they'll want to sell you all these things where you can monitor it and pay a subscription fee, and you can just look yourself. And then if you're already in business, you can look on Dun & Bradstreet and see what your business credit is. So the documentation that needs to be prepared for a loan application, in most cases, if it's a new business, and most banks for a new borrower, they'll want to see your business plan. And a business plan has in it, a description of what your business is, what it looks like, smells like, feels like, what the experience is of the person that's walking into your store, what your employees are like, who your customers are, what your competition is, what the geographical area of your market is, and the age niche of your clients. Just really sort of the descriptive part. It's the place where you really get to tell your story. And then the rest of what goes in a business plan is the kind of nutsy boltsy things that the banks like to look at. They want to see your projected financial statements, your pro formas, your feasibility study, and then tax returns, historic, new businesses don't have historic information, but the proprietors would. Anyway, so that's what goes in. And then when you're looking at borrowing, you want to look at, properly structuring your credit. So you want to borrow, like if you're going to put up long-term assets, like if you're going to purchase a building, you should be looking at 20-year payback. You don't ever want to have a short-term loan secured by long-term assets. And the banks will try and get you to do that because it's very secure, they like real estate, but what ends up happening is if you borrow $100,000 when you really need working capital and you put up your office building, then when you need to do something with your office building, you'll have to pay off that working capital loan in order to make that work. And so even if you refinance it, you've got those costs again, the new appraisal, the new loan fee, the new documentation fee, plus just the wear and tear. So you always want to try and match what your collateral is that you're pledging with the purpose of the loan and how long you're going to need the money. We already talked a little bit about inventory loans. Line of credit is a good thing to have if you're uncertain about your cash flow or if you have seasonal cash flow needs. A lot of businesses in Southeast Alaska are based on tourism or fishing, and so they only need money certain times a year. That sometimes you can get like a home equity loan for that kind of thing, depending on how much money you need. And that's the cheapest, easiest kind of money, and there isn't bankers not pestering you for financial statements. But, it can be expensive, too, if you don't pay it off. So the sources of financing are typically commercial banks, and there's commercial finance companies. There are not very many that are operating in Southeast Alaska, so I'm not going to talk about them. And then the Small Business Administration, SBA, guarantees a lot of loans, and most of the banks will offer SBA guaranteed loans. The pricing is a little bit higher because the banks have to pay the guarantee fees, and but that is kind of that'll help you get startup capital. And then there's state and local government programs and community revolving loan funds like the one that we operate. And then I put this link here, and it's also on your handout. This will take you to a page on our JEDC website where you can, maybe I should have, here we go. So there's a lot of information here about different kinds of resources that you can use. I don't know if you can even read that, but there's an outline for writing a business plan, and there's what you want to finance, and who will be the lender. So say you want to, you know, but you want to buy a vehicle. Say you have a delivery truck for your business. So who provides equipment financing or for a vehicle? So then all of these different lenders will come up, and then there's, you know, links. You can click to their links for those. Do you have anybody have any questions?
I do. So the SBA, because of what's going on with the feds, I mean, do you kind of have a feeling of, are they, it's going to be harder to get loans from them?
Well, they don't make direct loans. They don't. They never have made direct loans. It's a loan guarantee program, and I.
So they always go through a bank.
Yeah, you apply through a bank. There's some. One of the what we do is called gap financing, which is we work with people who can't quite qualify for all bank financing, and we try to leverage the money that we have. That was put up by the city and borough of Juneau. This is for Juneau deals. We have a couple of other loan funds. But we leverage that money with bank financing. So maybe a bank for a business that maybe you don't have enough collateral to meet all of the banks, and there's like a $50,000 that you need that's above and beyond what the bank will do. So we help you get that bank loan. We make the $50,000. We take like a junior lien or different collateral, or we'll patch together other things to make it work, or maybe a guarantee from somebody else to get you the financing, and then we do a lot of technical assistance too. But there's another organization that's called Alaska Growth Capital that does that kind of thing as well, and they have SBA guaranteed loans as well as USDA guaranteed loans. And your question was whether SBA's resources were going to be reduced. I don't know the answer to that. Their obligation is contingent. They don't have to pay unless the loans are bad. And the market in Juneau or Alaska, we've had very few foreclosures, or, you know, we have a stable, growing economy. We don't have unemployment. We don't have a lot of the bad things. But those are sort of national trends. And I could find out. And see, but I don't think so. I mean, the sequester is supposed to reduce cost by 10%, so I don't think that any individual borrower would really be impacted, or you wouldn't notice it as much. And there's also a lot of support. Everybody in the world says that small business is what's going to fix our economy, and so to cut the guts out of that really keystone program within the federal government's support for small business would be kind of counterproductive, counterintuitive anyway, but I can't speak for the government. I don't know what they do. Okay, I'm going to go back here. So anyway, the link to this is on that page. Okay. Whoops. Okay, now switched back to this. So the first thing I always tell people, always start with a business that you already bank with. They already know you. They already like you. They've spent a lot of their resources. hooking you up to all the different things that make it hard for you to leave, the bill paying and the retirement plan and all that kind of stuff. And so the chances are, even though you'd have to go talk to a different department about a commercial loan, they still want to keep your business. And if you've got a business that maybe you need a loan for some purpose, there's also, you know, they're going to have your business checking, they're going to have your credit card things. There's lots more ways for them to make money off of you. And so if you like them, that's always the best place to start. If you don't, then finding out from your friends where they bank and who they have liked working with is a very personal decision. So for starting up a business, you're typically going to have more equity than someone who's been in business for a while. And where that comes from, you know, from the banker's perspective, the place they like to see it the most is from your personal savings. You can also sell equipment, get rid of the second home, you know, the other things. You're not going to have time for it anyway if you're starting a new business. You won't, you know, the toys pretty much are going to have to go unless you have a lot of other money. You can get a second mortgage on your house. This is more the order that people do things in. Credit cards is like the worst way to borrow money for a business. People do it, and it makes sense if you don't need very much money, because if you're only borrowing, you know, $5,000 and you're paying 25% interest on it and you only need it for 3 months, it's still only a few, you know, it's not that much interest in terms of total dollars. But I've seen businesses that rack up, you know, over $100,000 in all different kinds of credit cards, and then you're, you know, spending all your time managing those minimum payments, and it's just eat it alive, and it's very, very debilitating. Family and friends is a good resource for helping to start a business. But it doesn't always have to be that they invest in your business. I mean, that's what people do. They get a loan from their parents or their trust or their, you know, their family members. But it could be that that the family and friends could put up some collateral or maybe guarantee, and then they're not really out anything unless your business fails, but it makes it more likely that you can walk into a bank and get financing. Other sources for financing startups that are not listed on here are, many people can borrow if you've got a self-directed IRA or a 401k plan that you can borrow from. That's a good source for financing. When you pay it back, you're paying yourself back, and the interest that you pay on it actually goes back into your retirement account. So if you have that option, that's what I would do. I'm going to quickly just go through. These are the local banks that are making business loans, local financial institutions. You can, all of them have websites. They all make different, they call them different things. They're some of them are different. Letters of credit is something that Alaska Pacific Bank doesn't, I mean, they might do it, they don't advertise it. But Alaska USA, which is a credit union, they've been in making business. Credit unions have been making commercial loans for about 6 or 7 years. Letters of credit, if you're doing kind of importing anything, foreign transactions, to be able to, you know, get that company in China willing to send you their widgets before you actually pay for them. They want some kind of a guarantee that they're actually going to be paid. And a letter of credit is a third-party guarantee from a bank. The bank will issue that to the company so that the company has the security to send you the goods, and then they'll underwrite it like a loan, even though they may not even ever disperse anything. USDA is the United States Department of Agriculture, and then ADA, I'll talk about them later. Denali Alaska Credit Federal Credit Union, they have some commercial loan things that are sort of tailored on their consumer loans. So they've made personal loans for boats and planes and those kinds of things, but they sort of modified them a little bit so they're suitable for businesses. But that's a good resource. First Bank Alaska, that's the one that's based in Ketchikan. They have a long track record in Southeast, and they do a lot of fishing kind of businesses. commercial real estate construction. I've been trying to get them to do a subdivision development loan, and they haven't been doing it for a while. I mean, all the banks got out of that when the market crashed nationally in 2008, but now they're starting to get interested in it again. This is the typical menu that you would see for a small business banking kind of operation. First National Bank of Alaska is the oldest bank in Alaska, and they have offices all over the state. They're a very hard bank to get into, but once you're there, they treat you really well from a lending side. One of the things that they have that nobody else does is this escrow receivable department, which is a way of, if you have a seller financing or a friend that's going to lend you money, they have a way of keeping track of, you pay them and then they disperse. So it's like they keep all the records, they do the reporting. It's sort of, you know, you're not having to send money and make sure that your friend knows how to do loan accounting. It's a way of making that relationship work in a more business-like fashion, and they don't charge very much for it. I think it's kind of a cool thing that they do. Revolving lines of credit is like if you wanted to have like a working capital loan, you would renew every year for inventory purchases or something that was like seasonal. KeyBank, you know, they're the ones that just, you know, everything fits within those categories and they'll just deal with you. They have, they can do everything everybody else can do, but they don't try and curve. And then Wells Fargo, they've got little trademarks on everything that they do as if nobody else makes a business term loan. I mean, they all, it's just their way of doing things. But they all, pretty much all do SBA loans. They all have lines of credit. They all do real estate loans. Whenever you see Express, that means they've got kind of a expedited underwriting process. Maybe they don't require as much collateral. There's supposed to be a rapid turnaround in approval. It's really, whenever you see Express, it's really the loan is going to be based on your credit. This is our program, Southeast Alaska Revolving Loan Fund, and I don't know if you're all familiar with Tracy's Crab Shack behind the library. Well, we financed that. That was a loan that I did about 8 years ago, and she wanted money we've made other loans than that, but I think it's a good example that a lot of people know. It's a seasonal business, only open for a few years. It was a startup. She'd never had a business herself, but she had a long track record in tourism and was very interested in food, and she wanted to give people this crab sort of experience. Her idea was a very rustic thing. It was going to just be a shack, and people were going to get buckets of crab and sit there and eat them, and, you know, the shells are going to pile, and then there'd be storytelling and be kind of a fun thing for people to do. And it's moved on from then, but we financed those buildings that she had built and working capital and all the equipment and everything else. We worked with, I think it was First Bank, because we partner with banks, and then helped her. We've done a number of different things. She's got a liquor license now, and we've had to, you know, buy big years of crab, you know, all at once to kind of lock in the price as a real working capital loan. And she's been very successful. One of the things that's made the business really successful is the liquor license, so she being able to serve beer and wine. But it's a, you know, our typical customer cannot get, you know, a bank loan all on their own, and we help them do that. And then there's a lot of technical assistance too, a lot of management coaching, a lot of, why do you want to do that? Or, you know, and let's walk through what that cash flow looks like if you do X versus Y. I wanted her to buy used buildings, but, you know, we looked for some and couldn't find them. They would have been a lot cheaper, and she would have started out with less debt, but it didn't work out. And then after we bought them, then we found some that was kind of, but you can get used restaurant equipment. There's a lot of ways to save money. But her business has been very successful, and she employs about 20 people in the summertime, which is You know, that's what we're here for. And that's one of the things with local and state and local government programs. A lot of them will have a jobs component or jobs requirement. And so if you're not in a business that's going to create a lot of jobs, then that might not be as good a fit. But we certainly, our mission at JADC is, I mean, we make loans in our loan program, but I also really feel strongly that our mission is to help people have access to capital. And so if you're really a good candidate for a bank loan, I'll help you get a bank loan. And if that means reviewing your business plan, it's always a good idea to have that kind of support before you go to a bank, because you never get another chance to make a first impression. And you don't want your deal to have 10-foot pole marks all over it by the time you finally find a lender, because that'll cost you in terms of interest and fees. It's more expensive when they're not really thrilled. And then Alaska Growth Capital is another mezzanine financer, and they're able to do SBA guaranteed loans and also offer USDA guaranteed loans, which has meant that they have their portfolio, I think, is up to almost 200,000 or 200 million in loans outstanding, and they loan all over the state. And I worked with them as a consultant when they were first getting set up, and they've really grown a lot. It's kind of encouraging to see. It's owned by Arctic Slope Regional Corporation, but it's operated as a sort of a separate for-profit subsidiary. And they do a lot of technical assistance as well. They have kind of strategic planning that they offer, and they'll want to do your books for you and that kind of stuff. As a borrower, I wouldn't want that, but they like it because then they can see what you're doing, which once you've got their money, you don't probably want that. Just, it's important to maintain some distance between the lender. Get all the help you can get from them, but maintain your own control. These are the federal loan programs. These are offered through most of the banks. SBA Express Loans, this would be a bank loan, and it's, you know, they'll do unsecured loans. And I think that goes up to $50,000. It's basically based on credit. It's an, expedited underwriting. The 7A term loans is the typical SBA guarantee program. And they will work with startups, and they pretty much can do any business purpose for the loan, whether it's business to purchase a business, to purchase real estate, to purchase equipment, inventory financing, working capital loans. You know, if you want to launch a website or any of that kind of stuff, you can get an SBA term loan for that. These SBA 504 loans is it's a special program that they put you together with a bank and another SBA 504 lender, and the bank will loan 50% of the project. It's for real estate and like heavy equipment, like if you bulldoze or something like that, or a big production line or some other big piece of equipment. And the bank will only borrow, they like it because they only have to put up 50% of the loan. They get first lien position on the asset. And then the SBA will fund 40%, take a second lien, and then you only have to come up with 10%. So it's the difference between 10% and 20% on a real estate purchase. It makes it much more attractive on a cash flow basis for a starting business, or a business where you're expanding but your sales haven't caught quite up. And their rates are very low. So you get longer term to pay it back, lower rates. And the Evergreen Business Capital, they're based in, well, it's a Northwest, but they have an office in Palmer. And the lady up there who runs that office is really focused on, they have like a sort of a community development goals. So she did a loan for a business out behind the Nugget Mall that does the fireplaces. I forget what the name of it is, but they had something that they were doing with their real estate, and she wanted to do a 504 for, I think it was leasehold improvements. It was sort of long-term leasehold improvements. They were expanding and moving into a different site. And, you know, she was looking for, you know, letters of support from the community, and we helped her with that. So they have some kind of a feel-good component to what they're doing that, you know, then they're creative to make that program work. But for long-term assets, this is a really good kind of loan to get. And most of the banks will do 504 loans. Then the federal loan programs are mostly specific to certain industries, so like fisheries or to buy permits, fishing permits. BIA has a loan guarantee program for Alaska, well, any native. You can be any kind of native in Alaska and get that. And it doesn't, they don't make you loan, but if they'll guarantee it, then it typically reduces the interest rate that the borrower will pay. The USDA makes it, they have a direct business industry, they had a direct loan program. These are the guarantees loans, I believe, is what they're doing now. And they're starting to see that pick up. I was talking to them yesterday, and they said they were doing a lot of fishing kind of loans. Are any of you interested in fishing? Okay, I'm going to skip through all this then. The state of Alaska has two loan programs. I'm not sure whether Juno projects qualify, but I'm going to take you to another source. I think they're more rural. I think you have to be in a town of like less than 5,000 people for one of them, and I'm not sure which is which. But these were, for a long time, the lowest cost money that anybody could get for commercial loans. So if you qualified for it and you could put up with their bureaucracy and get through it, it was, you know, 4% loans when everybody else was doing 8 and 9. And they seem to always have money. They seem to not always have really good business plans to look at. And so it's definitely worth a call. And their office is over Vintage Park. They're part of the permanent fund, but it's the Division of Investments runs both of these programs. And their job creation programs and business startup programs. And this is the other one. And then ADA is Alaska Industrial Loan Program. They have two parts to ADA. One is like public infrastructure, gas lines, and docks and harbors and things that they fund directly, and they also do bank guarantee loans where, like a 504 loan, they'll do 20 years on a business, and whereas the bank will do 10 at a lower interest rate. So it's a participation with the bank. You apply through the bank, but it gives you a way of leveraging government resources to get a longer repayment term and also a lower interest rate. And they have a lot of money. And then these are some other resources. JDC is our organization, and we do a lot of other things besides financing. We have, we do industry development works. We're downtown revitalization. We work in housing and homelessness. We have a lot of different entrepreneurial kind of support activities. The Small Business Development Center is funded by the Small Business Administration and the University of Alaska, and their office is on the third floor of the Empire Building. They'll give you free, private, confidential business consulting, help you put together a business plan. They run workshops, and I will just see if I can open this. They used to have a local website, but now you go onto the state, and say, so click on workshops, and then let me see. My eyes are going bad. Somewhere.
Yeah. It says Juno, but it doesn't.
Yeah, there's no link there, but there is. See, I just was on here and I found it. Let me just put in Juno.
Okay.
Workshop.
Okay, I'm sure we'll be posting this on the web.
Am I over my time? I'm sorry.
No.
Oh.
Okay.
Anyway, you can go on there, and they are running workshops. I think some of the current offerings are writing a business plan, They have this profit mastery thing, which is like how to manage profitability. They used to have some kind of brown bag workshops for people that were thinking about starting businesses and where you could sort of brainstorm. Those networking opportunities are really useful, I think. And then I was going to say this site that the state offers, there is a ton of information here. And some of it is very stale and not up to date, but a lot of it that's not. Like if you're making anything here, the Made in Alaska, the Silver Hand, they help with export. It's just pretty comprehensive. And there's a lot of information here for all different kinds of businesses with resources. They used to have a sort of an interactive database of providers of financing, technical assistance, and grants where you could search, you know, what industry you were in or what you were looking for or where you lived, and then the resources would come up. And we haven't gotten any requests for update or information. I can't find it anymore, but it seems to have morphed into this, which is not hard to use. I wanted to tell you about a couple of things that state has what I think are really good. There's a Starting a Business in Alaska work booklet that is really good, and it's on here somewhere.
Yeah, that's Start a Business in Rural Alaska.
Well, it's not rural, it's just anywhere.
At the very top, under For Profit, a booklet on starting a small business.
Yes, okay, a small business. And it has everything about permitting and insurance and labor rules and you know, when you need a DEC permit and when you need a special license, like for contractors or massage therapists and beauty parlor operators, all need special licenses. If you're in that, you probably know, but it just really walks you through it. And then there's the Department of Labor has good worksheets too. So if you need help, call. And I would encourage you to do a business. I mean, it's the best place to make money, working for other people. You can never make as much money as you can make for yourself. You don't have the risk, though, either, but it can be fun.
Thank you.
You're welcome.
Thank you.
I guess that's all.